Hey guys, I'm Matt Ducker. I'm senior editor at Epicurious, and I'm really excited to be here at South by Southwest with two guys that are just really in an interesting space right now. We're going to talk about live video in a minute, but we're going to talk about something that happened a decade ago first, which is YouTube, which is the company that you guys, that Steve, that you co-founded, and Vijay, that you were the engineering manager at and had a hand in making it is what it is today. Talk to me about what happened in 2005 with video. What did the landscape look like? I think it's even hard for us to kind of wrap our brains around what YouTube was when it was a startup, when it wasn't owned by Google, and online video was kind of in its infancy. What was the landscape like?
Well, I mean, I think it sort of blossomed and exploded so quickly that oftentimes we don't remember what it was like before YouTube came around, right? I think YouTube itself was the idea, the domain name was registered on, I remember this, Valentine's Day, 2005.
How did that come up? What, like you wake up in the morning and you're like—
There were three guys behind YouTube and Valentine's Day, we didn't have anything to do,
right,
so
yeah,
we were
right.
sitting in the garage together.
Of course.
So we registered domain name. One of the things, I do remember this, and I should have taken a screenshot, was on that day before we registered the domain, we went on to google.com and searched for YouTube and zero results came up.
Right.
And you know, it's hard to believe now, but I think even harder to believe was that back then, and this is, you know, 10, 11 years ago, but at that point there was, you know, there was a Real Player, there was QuickTime, there was Windows Media Player, there was, I think, over 220 different types of audio codecs, over 120 different types of video codecs. And so if you ever took a video on your, whether it's Sony, Panasonic, Canon, whatever, and the iPhone wasn't there, right? So
sure.
If there was any one of these digital cameras and you wanted to share that video with somebody else, it was really impossible to do. It was too big to be able to embed into an email. And even if you could actually transport it to whoever the recipient's computer was to actually play that back, it was unlikely that they would have the same video codecs and audio codecs installed on their computer. So I think it's hard to believe that just video was impossible to share 10, 11 years ago. And even when we first started, and we'll talk a little bit more about this with Nam, about live video,
right.
Because I think it's in a similar environment now with live videos. It's getting started, but there's still some of the same challenges. But at that time, it was impossible to do, but it's hard to think that over a period of just 1, 2, 3 years, YouTube grew so quickly and it became more or less the dominant way that you would share videos publicly. It would be just privately or public. If you had a piece of content that you wanted, if you had it from your kid's birthday and you wanted to share with grandparents from halfway around the world, this is the way to do it. If you had a video that you took of yourself singing in front of a mirror without a recipient in mind and you wanted to share this around the world, this is the place that you would do it at.
And you know, I think we think of YouTube now as, you know, the only, you know, one of the major destinations for online video, but at the time, we were just having a conversation outside about all the press you've been doing for NAMM and all the questions. You guys have interviews with USA Today, Squawk Box, you know, all sorts of people. No one was asking questions about YouTube for a few months. You guys were able to kind of launch quietly. What happened in those first few months? And I know there was some pivoting and some original ideas that maybe didn't quite work out. What are some of those things that got left on the cutting room floor that people might not quite know about?
Well, I think it's definitely the majority of companies that start in Silicon Valley. The story that you hear about how the company started is completely false.
Right.
It's coming from
right.
your first meeting with the PR agency and the first thing that you talk about for that. And this was certainly the case at YouTube. We talked, there was one thing that we resolved with the PR agency, the external PR agency that we hired, which was, what will your answer be when somebody asks, how did YouTube start? And we came up with this, and at this point, I can tell that
Vijay,
in my
you're
sleep.
Here too during all this.
I know this part of the story could be true, could not be true.
I have a lot easier time telling the untrue story, the false story about how YouTube started
right.
versus how it actually started.
Well, we want the real story. I don't want any false stories. So what's the real line?
I mean, the real idea there was thinking that, you know, back in 2004, late 2004, We use Flash Video, Mac Media Flash Video, to encode all the videos. And so there was finally, and at that point, Flash was installed in over 95% of browsers. And so we thought that here's an opportunity finally where people, all 95% plus people, had video and audio codecs installed in their computers that was compatible with everybody else. Broadband penetration in the US had reached over 50% just that previous year. So it's not just the downstream, but also the upstream. So at that point, I think many attempts have been made up to that point about trying to do a video product. But it wasn't that the idea wasn't good enough, but it just was the technology wasn't there. And certainly by the time the iPhone came about, everybody had a device in their pocket that could be taking videos and could be streaming videos and uploading videos. So the real boring but true way that YouTube started was we were talking about what else we could do, and it seemed like it was the right time to do something with video.
Right. But I mean, the story that you told me yesterday was that YouTube started as an online video dating site for 1 week. That was the original idea.
Well, there was a, I think there's definitely.
Did I get that wrong? Or I mean, that's something that you told me that I thought was pretty interesting.
Yeah, that was what I told you, but I didn't think we'd be talking about it on stage.
That's the whole point. That's why we're here. But I mean, I think it was a really, so one of the things we were talking about was, you know, obviously you're starting a new company now, and YouTube was a startup. It wasn't always acquired by Google for $1.6 billion in 2006, and it was a small company that had a lot of ideas, and I think one of the things we wanted to talk about on stage, and we'll get to it a little bit later, was the idea that you have to be comfortable pivoting and kind of listening and reacting to your audience.
Yeah.
So you had an idea that maybe wasn't quite what it should have been, or it's something that wasn't, the time wasn't right, or the execution.
So we always thought there was something with video there, right? It was kind of the obvious next step beyond photos, beyond sort of text and images. But we started thinking about what would the actual, so that was kind of the underlying technology layer. So what would be the actual practical application that we could layer on top of that? And we thought dating would be the obvious choice.
Single guys registering domains on Valentine's Day thought they might have started dating.
And I think after 5 days passed by and not a single person uploaded, and they were supposed to make video intros of themselves and say, this is who I am, this is my age, and I'm looking for somebody to date in my area. And after 5 days passed by, we started reconsidering. Still, the technology was there,
right.
So it was easy enough to kind of pivot to doing something that was, all right, forget the dating aspect of it. Let's just completely open it up to say any video, regardless of whether it had anything to do with, you know, your age or your gender, you can upload it to YouTube and you can share it. And then we started seeing kind of the cute cat videos and the kid videos starting to show up on the site.
And you know, Vijay, you're there during this time and working on the engineering side. What was there a moment, it might be the same for both of you, but was there something when a video got uploaded where you kind of were like, oh, we're onto something? Was there one specific thing? You know, I know the dog skateboarding.
The skateboarding, you know, dog is pretty insane. I don't know if you've seen this video, but it is literally like a pit bull getting on a skateboard and going for a good, like 30 seconds, and it blew my mind.
I think like 700 million people have seen it. So the five people in the audience have probably seen that video.
Right. Sure. This was like pre like cheeseburger, any other like real meme, but that was a true legitimate meme. I actually think like YouTube in a lot of ways started this like kind of meme industry that now has grown to become like an empire for a lot of different startups. But YouTube was kind of the first like, you know, institution to think about the fact that people have really short attention spans. You can watch something. You have to like communicate something to people during that time period that is either inspiring or maybe the opposite of inspiring and just totally like off the base or off the wall. But thinking about that like short time window people have in their lives to watch a video and then find something that makes them interested enough that they want to talk to someone else about it. I think YouTube first pioneered that. And it's carried all the way through for the last couple of years. We've always thought about the first 2 seconds of a video playback. That's the numbers that you want to be tracking. What do users actually do after they watch the first 2 seconds of that video? If they don't like that video, can we get them to another video that they would like? Can we draw any signals from that to say what is the next video they might like? And that could be a positive signal or a negative signal. But I think everybody now is thinking about this. And YouTube, I think if we hadn't started off like having that skateboarding dog, probably people wouldn't have realized how important of a trend this was.
Do you agree with that, Steve? I mean, was there something that came to mind when I asked that to Vijay? Was there a moment that you saw where you're like, oh, this is working? Or is it not that clear when you're kind of in it?
Well, I think, and this has been quoted a few times, but I think one of the first videos, so, you know, we started in February and launched in May, the dating site in May, and then shifted, pivoted in
YouTube
mid-May.
Dating, yep.
And this is 2005. Even still to this day, I don't think there's a dating video on YouTube. But, you know, this was around mid-May of 2005. But I don't remember exactly when, but there was a video that was uploaded by a user whose name was Joe B. And it was Ronaldinho. And so that was a while ago. This was Ronaldinho, and it was a video of him kind of bouncing a soccer ball off the top of the goalpost. And it ended up being, we did the research, and it ended up being a video that was uploaded by Nike. And they wanted to kind of stay in kind of the hip user-generated content. So the name that they thought was most closely related to user-generated was Joe B and
right.
Nike. and we that sort of kicked off a conversation with Nike. So that was, I think, the first one where here's a legitimate company that's trying to get onto the user-generated content scene with a video. But then I think fast-forwarding 2 years, there was... I know President Obama was here, but this was in 2007 when the primary debates were going on. Yep. And so this was in South Carolina, and it was, this was already after the Google acquisition, but it was a deal where we worked in conjunction with CNN, and people were asking questions over CNN, and we were sort of putting them on stage, and this was the submitted questions were coming in as uploaded, so you could actually see not just the question or the audio side of the text, but you can actually see the user, and I think that brought a whole new dimension. You can see the background of, you can see the person that's asking the question, but I think that really put a stamp of legitimacy onto YouTube. Here's something that's on sort of primetime TV that's part of the sort of the elections, and was working with CNN to actually surface some of this content yeah. onto the web.
And then you mentioned, but you know, as everyone in this room knows, Google purchased YouTube in 2006 for $1.6 billion, which at the time I think people thought was crazy, and now is probably the best purchase any tech company's ever made. That legitimized online video in a way too, and it allowed you guys to you know, have not zero results for YouTube in Google, but probably quite a few. How much did that just change everything? Obviously, it changed everything. But can you talk a little bit about that time and going through that acquisition and what you learned and how the company grew and changed almost immediately?
Yeah, I mean the whole conversation between Google happened within about 72 hours from the first time we talked to Google about the acquisition to the time it was announced after the closing of the stock market on Monday.
Until they brought the big check over, $1.6 billion, Steve. Yeah, wow.
I mean, there's a lot of fun events that's all compressed into those 72 hours, right? One was that we didn't want anybody to sort of recognize us on the Google campus. We didn't want, you know, Eric Schmidt, Larry, Sergey to be seen anywhere near the offices of YouTube. So we said, okay, well, let's meet at some place where it met two criteria. One of them was that it's gonna be somewhere kind of in between Google and YouTube. So YouTube at the time was up in San Bruno and Google was in Mountain View. So in between there's Woodside, California. And we thought the place that nobody would recognize us would be the Denny's restaurant that's right off of the highway. So that's where we chose to meet. And so here's the CEO, the two co-founders yeah. of Google, and here's the two co-founders of YouTube.
Some Grand Slam breakfast, yeah.
And nobody recognized us. They came by and asked what we wanted to order.
Yeah.
But I was too nervous to order anything to eat in front of the field. but everything was compressed together very quickly. But I think thereafter, it was, I think there were a few other choices, interested parties in acquiring YouTube. The best one still to this day, no regrets about Google. I think that just the way that the company is arranged, they have different verticals that are very focused on just one, not the product, but the technological side of things, and so we were able to, at the time, we needed desperately help in internationalization, localization. So over 50% of users coming in for YouTube was coming from outside the US, but we didn't have a team internally to be able to launch the international effort to do the translation. And then mobile was going to be a big thing, and that was also a team that we didn't have internally to be able to do ourselves. But Google obviously had mobile teams working on different parts of their products. And so it was a good fit to be able to kind of pick and choose the different teams we wanted to work with at Google to be able to help out YouTube's efforts.
So you both stay on at Google for until 2009 and 2010. And during that time, you start thinking about what you're going to do next, and you start having conversations about live streaming, which is why we're here today and what we're here to talk about. Can you tell me about some of those early conversations and, you know, between you two, where those things happened, what you guys were talking about?
Yeah, yeah. Steve had a place up in Napa, and so I remember some of the early conversations were just driving up to Napa and sitting down and trying to have lunch and talk at the same time. Steve has this great wood-fired pizza oven in the back of this place. And at this time, you know, I think now maybe Steve can do a better job of making pizza, but this time he's just learning. And so not every lunch actually was a successful pizza lunch.
Still better than Denny's. Right. So, I mean, it's not bad.
But we realized, like, we had lunch up there. We had lunch at Google. Google has, like, a bunch of amazing cafeterias. There's one that... It's called Kitchen Sink, but it's spelled S-Y-N-C right. instead of S-I-N-K. Yep, yep. It's kind of like a residency for all the best chefs around Google. So they'll spend a month in there, and they'll work on like whatever dishes they want. And they get really inventive and creative with what they do there. And we'd be sitting down and having these meals and trying to talk about like ideas for startups and tech ideas that were really inspiring to us. And live video was like something that we were like just getting our minds around and how we'd actually approach this. But we realized a lot of the time we were talking as much about the food we were eating or trying to cook or trying to like actually like plan for the next meal or dinner as we were the tech ideas. And I think that kind of was like an inspirational moment for us where we realized this isn't true just for us. It's kind of true for almost everyone else in the Valley and maybe everyone else on the planet now is that food is such a big part of our lives and it's become such a big part of our lives over the last few years that we all kind of get inspired by like what's the next cool thing we can eat, who's the actual chef making it, how did they come to this restaurant or this like cool Google cafeteria in order to make the food that we're eating today. But we realized actually a lot of times we didn't have the answers to those questions. So, you know, you'd be sitting down at a great restaurant in San Francisco and the chef would have an amazing story. Like, you know, maybe they grew up, you know, in the Bay Area, maybe they grew up halfway around the world. They brought their own unique vision of food and culture to San Francisco to talk about it. But you, just sitting down and eating the meal that they've given to you, you don't actually know these stories. And so we started to talk about like how we can merge together live video and this like new exciting like energy around food and cooking together. And that's kind of the idea for Nam from the beginning.
And I mean, this is 2009-ish, somewhere in the 2008, 2009, somewhere. What does live video look like at the time? I mean, we have Ustream and maybe a couple other platforms doing some version of live, mostly from desktop computers,
yeah.
Weird sync issues. What's the live landscape and what are the challenges, I mean, from a content and engineering perspective at that time, what were you guys looking at?
Yeah, it's in the last few years, it's really taken off. But it's still really in the early days. So I think a bunch of people tried it with different formats on desktop, and now you know it's been the last like 2-3 years that on mobile you can start talking about live video in a serious way. But it is a brand new medium, and I think people still don't exactly know what to do when they're live on camera a lot of the times. They don't know what they should be talking about, how long should a live feed be. Once I point an iPhone at someone, you know, usually they're uncomfortable for the first 10 seconds and they have no idea what they're supposed to say. And then they start goofing off and then you're not actually sure how long this is gonna keep going for. We realized that we had to think about live video in a more like intentional way. So who's actually gonna show up for this live stream? When are they gonna show up? What do they expect to see as part of it? And then as a creator, like what are you actually doing to present something to the world? And what are the tools that you need to make that happen? And we started talking about what those tools would be.
I mean, I think that if we were doing, for example, this talk 5 years ago, 10 years ago, right, saying something like a challenge out to the audience would be taking out your iPhone and going to just pulling out the browser and going to nam.com. And the fact that you can actually take a live stream without going back to your computer and having to upload this, but the fact that you carry something in your pocket that you can broadcast to 10,000, 20,000, 100,000 people, that's something that really came about with the same way that I think YouTube needed the digital cameras, the same way that it needed audio video codecs, and the same way that it needed the ability for people to have the amount of bandwidth for streaming upstream and streaming downstream to watch videos. I think the ability to have everybody having something in their pockets that can, a device that was capable of doing all the transcoding, being able to upload this content, and then streaming it to 100,000 people around the world, and not just here, but it could be, you know, it could be outside at the food trucks, and if you see something interesting out there, and it may not be that exciting when you're standing in line here, but it's definitely something that's exciting from someone that's around the world to see how, what the culture is like, what kind of food are you eating for lunch. Everybody has lunch, and it's just exciting to be able to see what halfway around the world, what somebody's eating in Sicily, what somebody's eating in Tokyo.
And I think we have a little video to show just to, you know, let people know what Nam looks like, so maybe we can get that up on the screen.
Welcome to Nam, a place to share your love of food, live on camera. We're a community for food lovers who create, share, and watch their favorite stories in real time. Our website and iPhone app allow you to easily produce rich multimedia shows. Simply sign up, take a look at what's live now, what's coming up next, and browse channels for something delicious. Personalize your channel with a photo and tell us more in the description. Ready for your Nam debut? Go live whenever you want, or save it for later. And tell your community to tune in. Not sure now's the moment? Post a photo, video, or GIF to your channel, or just chat with your favorite chefs, makers, and home cooks. There's so much to learn and discover together.
I like the bite out of the N at the end. That's a nice, that's good. So that's not, one thing to point out, if you guys have questions while you're listening to us, you can tweet them. You can tweet your question with the hashtag AskSteve. Sorry, Vijay, and we'll get to them at the end.
You can, but I'll also take questions.
Steve can also. So I mean, you just one hashtag though. So that's Nam. You focused around food. I think one thing you guys were just talking about was that, you know, food is something that is universal to everybody. But to create a product and sort of limit your audience in a way, maybe not the first thing. It's not what you did with YouTube. Obviously, you opened that up to everybody. What's the thinking behind that? I mean, obviously you're trying to create a community, which can be really powerful, but why limit the audience and start with food?
I think on two levels, right? And Vijay, feel free to pipe in here, but I think one thing is that food ended up being a lot bigger than what we think. I think the natural reaction that we get from people is that food is a very small vertical. But when we started working on the site, and we've been working on it for a few months, we just find out that almost every time we get together with family, with friends, the conversation ends up being about food. As sort of a new parent myself, and with kids, it's trying to kind of culturally teach them in a way, culturally, it's almost equivalent to sort of the food that's part of that culture. And so I'm always kind of teaching my kids about sort of what is the difference between sort of a Japanese, Italian, French, and Chinese food, and kind of just giving them some of that background. And I do think that there's a lot more to food than what we sort of identify with when we first think about, here's the site just for food.
Just food, yeah.
Yeah. And I think, you know, now's kind of the right time where people have connected food to so many different parts of what's going on. So it both like represents your city, like your hometown's represented by as much the food and like your favorite pizza place or your favorite Thai place that's in your hometown as it is like anything else that you could talk about it. And I think it's become something for people that they want to share with everyone else. So I don't know about your Instagram feed, but if I look at my Instagram feed, like, you know, 50 to 80% of my photos are all like meals or photos or foods are taken, or like it's a video clip taken over a meal. And the act of like eating with someone tends to be like that gathering point where interesting things happen. And so just starting with food, you know, actually turns out to be for most people, that's like one of the most important social parts of their day. So it actually connects you to every one of your friends, everyone that you'd ever like talk to or communicate with. And I think people want to express that, but telling people like food is the starting point gives you an opportunity to do that within some context that gets people excited. I think if we just said, oh, it's open for everyone, you're kind of back to that problem of you're alive on camera, what do you actually talk about? At least with food, people, everyone has like their own perspective and their unique voice around what gets them excited around food that hopefully they'll bring to the site.
So I know NOM launched 5 days ago now, so if we're pretty early on here.
Yeah. But
what are you seeing the reaction from the community? You know, we've at Epicurious, we've been doing live streaming on Facebook Live, which happened to come out just a little bit before for you guys, and we're going to get on NOM and do that as well. But the engagement has been incredible. You know, we're seeing on Facebook where we have a huge audience already. Our live posts are 95% are more engaging than 95% of our other posts. So I mean, it's really in the top echelon. People just seem to love watching us live, and it's not perfect. It's raw. Things get messed up, and we love that. And I think that's a challenge for some people that are, you know, maybe not used to working that way. But what is it about live for the content creators, for the consumers of the content, and for you guys as you know, product people? Yeah. You know, how does that change things? How does that kind of that the rhythm between a person who's creating content and people responding to it in real time, which is just different from what happens on YouTube where you upload a video and it goes and gets comments later and you can go back, but how does live have the ability to shape content in a way that just other mediums don't?
I mean, I think it's a very sort of collaborative, interactive experience, right? So on YouTube, no matter what happens, no matter how you feel, no matter what comments you leave, the video is going to end. It's a movie. It's going to end the same way. Just having watched a few days of content on NOM, you see that there's this interaction going on. And there would be certain times throughout the actual NOMcast itself when the host asks, you know, this, it was an asparagus soup she was making, right? And it was an hour and a half to make this because she was interacting with her audience the whole time. And she said when she first finished the soup that it's still a little runny. And what would the audience think about adding something in here? And so she got a lot of different opinions. And there were a few chefs in the room, and they said, we would typically add cornstarch in there to actually thicken things up. And she didn't have any cornstarch, so she looked at what else she had. And she had some kind of like garbanzo beans ended up.
She's just like going into her cabinet with the live stream. This is all happening.
And so in a way, it's like you don't know, and she doesn't know. The host doesn't know. The viewers, they don't know how this video is going to end. It's kind of this choose your own adventure playing along with the host. And so I think that's kind of exciting, is that when you're leaving a comment, not only are you just leaving a comment for other viewers to see, but potentially you're actually changing the outcome of what this video is.
Yeah. And have you seen people responding to that? You know, I mean, like, in, you know, they're getting in the comments, they're doing that. You saw that one example. Vijay, you've been trying to get into the comments as well. You were saying that people maybe don't respond to your comments, but when your fiance gets in there, they respond to her.
Yeah, for some reason, people see my face and they see I'm leaving a comment, and it was like three college dudes that were cooking and listening to Bob Marley along with this like avocado fries recipe. My comments, they had no interest in responding to me whatsoever. My fiance got on and started posting, and immediately they're like, "What sort of music you want to listen to?" And she's just like, "Oh, maybe you could give a shout out to Tycho." And they're like, "Oh, great, we have no idea who that is," but they looked them up on Spotify and started playing along in the
there
background.
There you go.
They're grooving along. So, maybe your results may vary, but it's really fun when like the host actually sees what's happening in the audience and they try to play to the audience a little bit. I think people actually kind of get into that. I think if you don't know anyone's watching, doing live video is actually not that much fun because you're kind of like talking into the ether. When you know there are people out there and they're actually replying to you and you see like an animated GIF of Bob Marley swinging around his braids while you're like cooking your dinner that evening, it's actually kind of fun to participate along.
And I think you guys talked about, you know, when you're launching a new product, sometimes there can be unintended features or things that you were missing that people kind of build into the, you know, they make out of your system, they hack features. We were talking about Twitter the other day, and you know, hashtags weren't a part of Twitter in the beginning, and the users kind of demanded it and wanted it to be a part of it. Have you seen anything with NOM where people are using live or features that you built in a way that you maybe didn't intend for?
Yeah, you know, actually one of the most fun examples we've seen, so we have this idea of reactions that you can give really quickly as a viewer. And we've been playing with it for the last couple of months, but we have a few of them built in. So there's like a thumbs up, a heart, an LOL you can give on a video. And it's just really fun because you can kind of spam it a little bit and then you see a bunch of things flying and you see what everyone else is doing and kind of play off that. But once the host started seeing those come in, They started jury rigging their own systems around that. So one house created like a video poll mechanism where it was like a short little video clip that they put as part of a show. And the video clip says, what do you think avocados represented in ancient Aztec culture? And like the heart meant fertility. Yeah. I think the thumbs up meant like an act of war or something if you offered to someone. And so you start seeing people like use these features to do their own little like polling systems. And when we saw that, I think what our first thought was, oh shit, we should do our own.
We should build a polling system.
Right. Is that exciting, frustrating, like seeing people use products in ways that you maybe didn't intend or you know, exposing things that, you know, why didn't we think of that first? I mean, what is that as a person who is a co-founder and
I mean, I think as and from the product side of things, right? I think that you must have some confidence in getting the 1.0 release out there. But just like YouTube, it's like there's the platform, there's the technology side of things, but obviously the dating aspect of YouTube didn't work out as planned. But I think here is that we even had some doubts about the dating aspect before we went out, but I think that there must be some conviction that this is what we're going out with, or else I think what you end up doing is just forever pushing off that 1.0 release because you're never sure if it's going to work out. And I think for us it was, we think this is what the 1.0 release is going to look like, and last Wednesday we unleashed it to the world. And I think a large part of that is not feeling too confident that we know the right solution to everything. And so there's a lot of, if you were to actually go to the site today, and if you were to mail support and say, here's something that I'm having trouble with on the site, or here's a recommendation, a suggestion, I love the site, but here's something you would want. I think you could benefit from this. There's a good chance that your response that you receive will be coming from Vijay or me, because we are always reading those comments. We are always, I mean, we force all the engineers to be subscribed to that. I think it's one thing to be building something. They love reading customer emails. But I think it's one thing to build this thinking that you know what's best. But I think until you actually see people use it, you don't know whether or not we should be promoting or demoting certain things on certain interfaces and certain flows. And so I think, again, I think it's really important for everybody to be aware of how users are actually using the site, and things that we thought would be used more ends up never being touched, whereas things like this we never have thought of ends up being ways. And so definitely in the 2.0 version of the site, or even sooner than that, we're gonna add ways to add polling into the actual videos.
And you know, one thing I was thinking about when Nam launched, it did launch pretty close to when Facebook Live launched. Periscope with Twitter has been around for a little bit of time. Why both of those people have built-in audiences. What's the challenge or the opportunity of kind of going outside one of those established networks to try to create your own community? And why would you do that? I mean, you guys both worked at a place, YouTube, which made YouTube, which has a huge audience. Why not just go back there and do it? Why go outside of something that already exists?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I think people want to connect with the people that make the things that they love and that they're passionate about. And I don't know if any social network has 100% captured that today. So hopefully you follow tons of great people on Twitter if you're a Twitter user, but you might not connect with that amazing chef that's now opening up a taco stand in the corner, or maybe they opened up like a new Indian restaurant on Rainy Street. And Twitter is like, for some people, maybe that's not the place where you would follow someone like that. But when that person shows, like, this is how I went from my food truck to this restaurant on a live video stream, and you get to participate along with like their new go-in fish curry that they're trying out, that actually turns into something I think a lot of people are interested in. And hopefully we build a way where people get excited and passionate about certain topics, and we're able to figure out this is what you would want to watch next. And that could be totally independent of any following that you're doing on Twitter or Facebook today. It could be just on the basis that you watched this amazing coffee video from Kona, and now Blue Bottle Tokyo is going to show you how to make a cappuccino. This is actually amazing for you to watch right now. So I think we want to base a lot more on like, just people's passions and interests and topics more than who they're following on Twitter or Facebook today. And so it's kind of a bold step. I think a lot of people, you know, immediately jump to thinking Twitter and Facebook's the place to be to get people's interests. But we're kind of starting from scratch with like food as its own little place where a lot of people are passionate, excited about this, and they don't really express that through following somebody today.
Well, I also think there's a big part of what we're doing, which is collaboration, right? I think that no restaurant is owned by or run by a single person. There are, even the smallest restaurant, there are people that are manning different stations in the restaurant, and especially as you get bigger, there's people that are just focused on, I don't know, the pastry chefs or something, and there are people that are just focused on kind of the line chefs. And so there's all these different people that are working as part of a, in the back kitchen in a restaurant. And I think that one of the things that we have is we're not focusing so much on the individuals on NOM, but more sort of the actual, what we call channels, but it's entirely of sort of a group of people that are collaborating and adding content together. So an entire restaurant would have a channel, and there could be 10, 15, 20 people that's all contributing content on there. Of course, there's content that they could be contributing on sort of the inside the kitchen, in the kitchen working. But the idea is that when the, you know, the sommelier is out there shopping in Napa for wine or something, he can actually take photos. Or when the actual chef is shopping at the farmer's market, he can actually take photos outside of the kitchen. And so that's when I think it starts getting pretty exciting about what the sort of when they're still thinking, their brains are still thinking about what their jobs are, but they're out of the kitchen and seeing what that life routine ends up being and how that bridges back to what they're doing that night.
You know, one question that is, I'm sure you're getting asked all the time, how is NOM different? I feel like, you know, there are other people doing live streaming. You guys are food focused. But I think some of the features you have, you have a slightly different maybe vision of what live streaming could be. I think I'm thinking about the ability to integrate other multimedia into your live stream. Basically the format for most live streams right now, whether it's Facebook, Periscope, whatever, you have somebody else filming, you're filming yourself, you're interacting with comments, maybe if you're doing it right and paying attention, and that's it. But NOM, you have the ability to do a little bit more, and I think I haven't seen that many other places.
Yeah, we've seen some test shows where it's actually not even someone on camera, it's just like a string of animated GIFs being shared. We've seen a bunch of shows where it's kind of like, guess what this is, and it's just like 20 like video clips like taken out of context, and you have to guess what the heck you're actually watching while you do it. And the audience gets into it. I think being able to throw like photos and video clips into the live stream actually like enriches in a way people didn't expect when they first try it out. It actually, you know, going into the show, you're thinking about what you're going to be talking about for the next 30 minutes, and so it's not just you on camera. You've actually got like a bit of an agenda, but I think an agenda in the form of animated GIFs instead of Microsoft PowerPoint actually turns out to be pretty interesting for us. And, you know, we've also been exploring other things around, you know, just how you arrange shows, how you do it as a team. I think, like Steve mentioned, a lot of the best people on the site, it's not just one person, it's actually a collaborative team of people making this happen. And we saw that YouTube, too. Like, the best channels were, like, not just one person, but usually, like, two or three or even, like, five or six people working together to get you great videos every week. And we wanted to empower all of them to work together to make these amazing shows. So they can work together to, like, share photos and video clips as part of a live stream. They can bounce ideas off each other. We've brought in multiple cameras in a really interesting way, so you can have both a laptop and an iPhone and kind of stream along from both. And we've kind of, you know, a lot of these were technical challenges. We're like, at first we're like, oh, this would be an awesome feature to have. And then, and like me, Steve, and Ryan, who we started us off with, we're all like, oh, let's get this done. And then like 2 months later, it's like, this is way harder than we thought it would be. But I think we've like tackled a lot of those technical challenges over the last couple of months, and we feel pretty good about people trying it out. And we have seen people try it out and find it really interesting and useful. And we're now like kind of excited to see what the rest of the world does with it.
Yeah. No, I mean, I've certainly been surprised at some of the content that I've gravitated towards. And so, I mean, as you mentioned, this is like day five since launch. And obviously, for any launch of a website, the last 2 weeks leading up to it, there's very little sleep. And then after the launch, there's very little sleep. But, you know, after it was the second day and after very little sleep, I was getting
you might have been hallucinating whatever you're about to talk about, but yeah,
But I mean I ended up watching another hour and a half of somebody making spaghetti, and there was no way if it was just a spaghetti video I would actually be watching it, but the engagement where you would be typing in something, asking them questions, or just joking along with them, and that immediate feedback of less than a second, they would be reading it and they would be giving you feedback, there is an experience there that's just unequaled elsewhere. And so anyway, I mean, if you haven't tried it, it's it's more fun than you think watching someone else cook and talking to them.
We're going to take some questions in 5 minutes. So again, if you have questions, go to Twitter, use the hashtag AskSteve. Both Steve and Vijay can answer questions. But we're going to spend 5 minutes talking about the future of live. So only 5 minutes, that's all we have, five minutes. Yeah, so we got to wrap it all up real tight in 5 minutes. Where is this going? I mean, when you guys started YouTube, I'm sure you couldn't have imagined that you would have, you know, YouTube celebrities that rival pop stars and other people in the food world. There's people with huge followings who are making real money off of their YouTube careers. Where are we going with live? And as you said, the technology is just getting there. It's really early on. But what will this conversation look like in 5 or 10 years when we all come back together here in this huge ballroom and talk about whatever comes next?
Well, I mean, one of the things that I would say I'm probably most disappointed by is the quality of the video itself. Not the actual quality of the content, but the actual physical dimensions of the quality. And that's just something that's the ceiling of it is going to be based on how much bandwidth you have available. It's not such a big deal when you're at home and you're cooking in your kitchen, but I think some of the fun content, again, is, you know, when you're walking about, when you're at a restaurant, when you're at a nice restaurant and you're getting a tour of the kitchen, for example, sure. When you're outside a taco truck and you're not from the area and you want to take a video of what it's like. And to be able to stream that real time, it takes, there's a certain amount of bandwidth that you need. And as you're walking around, sometimes you don't have access to that bandwidth all the time. On YouTube, it's not as big of a problem because you can always capture and upload it later. Right. But if you're doing live streaming and being able to also answer questions, that's a problem. I think that it's a natural problem that the sort of that will be solved because always more and more bandwidth in the last 5 years, there's been sort of a 10x increase in this bandwidth. And so that will continue to increase over time. And I think that's the major problem right now is that the quality of the content is not that good due to bandwidth.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, we've seen some, like, since we've launched, we've seen some great videos out of Asia, South Korea, and other countries. But the reality is the internet's actually a lot better in South Korea than it is in most parts of the US. And they have the upload bandwidth to do a 720p live stream that's very hard to do over here. But I think people are going to start to demand that. Like, you know, I think when you first try out live streaming and you never actually thought about the fact that you don't have great upload bandwidth from, you know, the corner store or from your home. But once you start to realize that, you kind of demand that in the future because this is the new way you want to connect with people. And I think it's just like the beginning of people figuring out how we build this infrastructure, how we get it done. And just like new ways to connect people where everyone's on an equal footing instead of just you as one of a million people watching the next Justin Bieber video. You're actually kind of participating along with what happens.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that's been the most interesting change from, you know, 1.0 live streaming where you're essentially a voyeur, commenting and interacting wasn't a part of it. Now you're able to comment, interact. Is there a feature that we can't even like wrap our minds around and that in 3 years is going to be the extra layer to live streaming? Is it adding another multimedia? I mean, what is it?
I think this is the end.
This is it. This is our, okay. Yeah. Well, very good. Well, that's what I've got. So I think we can take some Twitter questions if people have been tweeting along and asking those. So maybe they can throw those up on the monitor. Or maybe there are no Twitter questions.
We can ask our own Twitter questions on Steve.
Is that Siri? Sorry, I didn't get that. Did everybody hear that over there? Seems
Siri, amazing. Do you have a question?
Maybe that. We didn't prepare that. We could talk about some other stuff. It's all good.
Oh,
they are? Oh, they're not on our monitors. Awesome. Great. Thanks, guys. Here, we'll stand up and
watch
my mic. Great. No problem. Okay, Nosh Food Films. How do you see food brands finding a place on NAMM? As a guy who works for a food brand, that's a really great question. How am I going to do it? No, but this is one of those things that I was kind of talking about a little bit earlier, and I think for food brands, working at Epicurious, working at Condé Nast, which owns Epicurious, you know, we spend a lot of time making content perfect before it goes out into the world. I think like that's the model, whether it's there's our monitors, whether it's the magazine, you know, like at Bon Appetit or GQ or Vogue or, you know, any of these other places or online or the app like Epicurious, you create content, you develop recipes, and then you put them out into the world. And there are comments and user reviews, But the way that this works is so different, because when I think our most successful attempts at it have been when something kind of isn't perfect or doesn't go right.
Yeah.
Do you guys, obviously you're working with Punch, which is a great cocktail yeah. site, and a few other brands. How do you see brands interfacing with, whether they're individual influencers or just regular people,
yeah.
and that kind of all kind of coalescing and existing in the same place? I mean, is that a smooth thing that happens?
I think that, again, drawing and contrasting between sort of YouTube and Nom, right? I think on YouTube, when you're trying to advertise on YouTube, you don't know who's actually coming. You don't know what this person is necessarily interested in and what they're watching and what they're going to be sort of interested in buying. So you don't know exactly who's going to be watching the sort of the marketing and advertising content that you're throwing in front of them. I think it's a different case with Nom. Of course, we don't have the viewer numbers, but you do know that everybody that's coming, anybody that's uploading content, and anybody that's actually watching content on Nom is interested in buying that Kaffelon, cast iron
sure.
pan. They're interested in sous vide cooking. They're interested in cooking in some sort. And so I think that there is a bridge that's a much tighter bridge between the sort of this food vertical and anybody that's actually selling something in the food space.
Yeah. Are you seeing people trying to figure it out in real time? Like, I think like our first live stream, I think something you were talking about the early days of YouTube, like a lot of the videos, the first 5 seconds were, oh shit, I hit the video button. I think like there's a little of that with live stream. You're like, it's on. Do you see this kind of like people figuring it out and getting into the rhythm of what this is? And that's just a part of it that we all kind of need to adjust to this new way of broadcasting content.
Well, I think it's, there's a real aspect of it, which is, there's people that are creating content on Nom and they would say, all right, we're ready to eat. And then they dig into it and it's actually half raw and they have to put it back in the oven. Usually that's cut out of a YouTube video that's
yeah.
cut out of the Food Network. But in another way, that's kind of what people expect to see. I think
right.
that's the difference between it. It's not completely edited and polished and you get to see kind of the real life case of it. And it's like not just I screw up in the kitchen,
yeah.
but even real professional chefs screw up in the kitchen.
We made a donut ice cream cone, which is something we saw happening online and we wanted to see what that was all about. You take puff pastry and wrap it around an aluminum foil cone, wrap it in, dust it in a cinnamon sugar and you bake it in the oven. You could fry it as well. And we kept like opening the oven to see if it was done and it kept not being done. And the commenters were like, if you stop opening the oven, it will finish.
yeah.
So it's just like this, really, we know. Okay, we have another question here from, oh man, Rejosh Joseph. Cooking takes time. With edits not possible in live video, is there a risk for engagement rates to drop? Hashtag ask Steve.
Ooh.
I have an answer, but you.
Yeah, actually, like, sometimes,
but go ahead.
It's the moments where there isn't actually a lot of cooking happening that are some of the most fun moments in the video. And that's actually when you get a chance to like connect with the person at the other end of the camera.
Absolutely.
So, even if it's just like pasta and you're boiling water for like 10 minutes, if there are like 10 people in the stream chatting along with you, you can actually fill up that time pretty easily. So we have built features like photos and video clips and other things that you do in order to incorporate into the show. And so when you see, people watch Today Show and morning shows all the time, you see live cooking demos on there and there are always like, interactions between the host and video clips and photos. And it's pretty easy for people to figure that out.
Tightly edited.
Yeah.
But
it's actually just as much fun if you just kind of leave it freeform and you're like chatting with the people that are there, because they're all kind of people that came to your show because they're somehow interested in what you were going to talk about. Like if you're talking about pasta e fagioli, probably they came in because they wanted to ask you some questions about it. And having a little bit of downtime is a good time for you to actually do that.
Yeah. But I mean, we have seen a lot of content that's been shown where people have taken photos of what it was like before they started boiling something.
Right.
And so they do show that. And so on the Food Network, you're allotted 30 minutes to be able to produce a show, whereas that show can be anything that takes 30 minutes to make to something that's slow cooked over 6 hours, but they're forced to compress that into 30 minutes of time. And the way that I think you get around it is you either take a few photos or maybe you take a few clips, which we support, of saying this is what it was like before we started the process.
Sure.
And then maybe you get to choose where you want that live aspect to be, whether it's at the end, and if it's at the end, you show pictures of what it was like before you started making the food, and then if it's gonna be the beginning of it, you can show pictures of what it's like after.
Sure, sure, or something you did on your last cast last week, or
right.
you made improvements to in the meantime. All right, Stephen K says, what monetizations what monetization options are or will be available on NAMM? Monetization, great question. People make money off this? Can you guys make money?
Yeah, the answer is none. We'll never have any monetization.
Great, done, next question.
I mean, no, I think I think most important, and this was something at YouTube as well, for the first 3 years that YouTube was around, monetization was not something that we put, it was always in the back of our minds in the sense that the burn rate couldn't reach a certain ceiling because we knew that if we could, we had an idea of what the monetization, if we were to put that in place, how much money we'd be getting. And so if it was $5 CPMs, $10 CPMs, then we could never surpass that when it came to the burn rate of delivering 1,000 videos. But we didn't want to put that in place. I think that the worst experience, and this was at YouTube, but also at NAMM, was that you're interested in watching a piece of content and you're forced to watch 30 seconds of a pre-roll of something that's completely unrelated to what you're watching. So that's the experience that we don't want to put onto our users. If we're going to do any form of advertising, it's going to be related to hopefully something that's inside the video. And in our case, it's pretty easy because usually when you're cooking, you're using something that you could sell. And so we can work with, you know, pan makers, we can work with barbecue manufacturers. You know, there's a lot of areas that we can create these bridges that form so they can advertise on the site. But I think a big part of the reason that we would be drawn into doing monetization is we can actually share that revenue back to the people that are creating content. So hopefully it becomes kind of their primary jobs is actually creating content, creating their own food shows on NAMM, and then they can actually generate revenue from it.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. We've done like a bunch of barbecue videos, like folks from Kansas City, folks from Chicago, folks from Pacific Northwest doing barbecue, but like, and every barbecue video, people always ask like, what sort of grill are you using? Is that a four top?
Like, sure.
Yeah.
Dollar signs.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. But and then we see a video that uses the green egg, and like most people have no idea what a green egg is.
Right.
They start asking, what is that? Like, why would you use it? Why is it shaped that way?
And right.
So, it seems natural that we're going to find ways to just connect people with things they're excited about. And we're not going to try to force it in the early days.
Marcus has a question. How do you overcome the language issue? Can I interact in my local language? They might not be able to understand you, but you can try. You are global. You said you're seeing a lot of things coming in from Asia. Do you see, that's interesting. I mean, are people mostly live streaming in English, even if they're in South Korea, or are there just kind of like segmented pockets around the world so far?
I mean, I think video in general, and live video is definitely a part of that. Languages is not as big of an issue as most people think because there is the video aspect of it, right? And so you get to actually watch. It's, for example, for us to be able to walk into a restaurant where, you know, it's foreign foods are being served and you can't read the menu, you can still order and you can still consume the foods, and you can still kind of in the same way, you can still watch a video and how it's created because the tools are more or less the same.
Yeah.
I mean, of course, language will ultimately be something that we translate and we actually convert in the sort of internationalize the site for, but I actually think it's not as a top priority as it would be for other sites that don't have video, that don't have photos.
Yeah. We support emojis, which is the
universal language. Again, if you guys have questions in the audience, ask Steve. We'll get him up here. Leah asks, learning all about NAMM. Okay. How will your team make sure all content is actually related to food? This was a question I asked you yesterday. Are you taking down content that's not food related? If I want to put up something entirely, I don't know what that would be. If I want to put up something entirely different, how are you guys handling that? Are you just not promoting it?
I would say that, I mean, it's similar to kind of what we talked about earlier. I mean, this is still, again, day five, right? So we don't know what exactly the platform's going to be used for. We're more or less leaving all the content that's being uploaded to the site, that's being created live and broadcasted through the site on NAMM. And we're not taking it down. We may not feature it on the front page, but we're not taking the content down. And I think part of this is just as much of a learning phase for us, is to see how the site gets used.
Yeah. Really is like, because we're doing food, we know a lot about every single video that's going on the site. Like, you know, if it's about coffee, we kind of know a little bit from there about who's watching it and what they're interested in. So, you know, I think it's one thing to like look at what people get excited about and where they get excited about in a video and then try to make sense of that rather than try to force people to like, oh, it's got to be about coffee because you said right. It's going to be about coffee in the right. Title. It seems a little bit dictatorial to me.
Yeah, so, I mean, somebody was just making spaghetti and then talking for an hour and a half. I mean, it's entirely about spaghetti, yeah. And I watched the whole thing.
Yeah, you know? It's about life. Maria says, do you expect YouTube influencers to take to Nam as a second channel? Would love any thoughts on digital influencers on hashtag Nam. Good on the hashtags, guys. I assume you hope to have some crossover between established people on other social media platforms and the platform you guys are trying to build right now. But what would you say to that question?
I mean, I would hope their primary channel is Nam and YouTube becomes their secondary
there you go.
Channel. But I think that it's a different experience, right? And so you can always record the content and then upload it back to YouTube. But I think the experience on Nam is, although it's video, the whole live experience and in interacting with people that's watching this video is a very different experience. And so I do think that, of course, I think at the end of the day, if you've been successful on YouTube, there's a certain sort of entertainment quality that you have that people are attracted to. And so you're most likely going to succeed also on Nam, but I think that interactive experience is just something that you don't get on YouTube. And on Nam, it's a very different experience. I would say you should give it a shot and give it a try.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I really understood until we did our first live stream just how real and immediate and different it was than producing video, which is what I do most of the time at Epicurious, producing video to tape and edit and going through rounds and rounds of notes. Yeah. There's something really exhilarating about it, and if you guys haven't tried it yet, you definitely should. Tracy says, as you build the Nam community, how are you thinking about how the community can connect with each other after the stream ends?
Yeah, I mean, that's a huge part of what we've done from the beginning. When you watch a video, you're watching it within a channel. But a channel is probably very different than what you've seen before. It's actually closer to like a Slack channel than it is, you know, a YouTube channel. It's actually a place where the community lives. And so, you know, we've had a bunch of like YouTube influencers and Instagram influencers joining the site, and they basically bring their following over, and the following comes along before the show starts. It comes along after the show ends. They're posting photos and video clips, and people are like commenting on that, like in the days leading up to a show. There are a few folks at
Twitch works that way. You see people kind of debriefing and pre-gaming in a room before somebody makes their Twitch
broadcast. If you're a creator, that's like 50% of the fun is like the audience coming in, they're like kind of guiding along what your next show is going to be. And so we tried to make that as collaborative as possible and try to make it as real-time as possible, even if there isn't a live video happening.
Okay, Cortimax, can you stream 360 video? No.
Well, if you have a 360-degree camera, I mean, I think that that's probably when we talk about live streaming, that's probably live streaming 2.0 is when people can actually start doing this. VR is a big thing. But I think there's even, I don't know, more challenges with trying to take 360, just the amount of bandwidth that you're going to need, the actual
equipment required to do it.
Cameras that aren't out there yet to be able to carry around this thing as you're walking around the street. So it's something that we're definitely looking at because I think it would be a cool experience to be able to see inside the, for example, a 3 Michelin star kitchen and be able to see 360 degrees to see what this station is doing, how the actual dishes are being plated and actually taken out. But I think the equipment is just not there yet to be able to make that happen.
It's probably gonna be our last question. Jorge asks, what are you gonna make with all the data that you are going to collect? Who owns the content?
Yeah, all the data is about food, so I'm not actually sure what we're going to do with it, but it's going to be pretty yummy. But who owns the content? You know, we think it's important that people kind of own their own shows that they produce. You can, if you're not comfortable with anything you've done live, you can take it down after the fact. But we hope a lot of people leave their videos up because we think over time we've kind of built up this library of amazing experiences around food and cooking. And the idea that you can go back and see, you know, years worth of cooking videos or like baristas making coffee and kind of scan through the best moments of those videos, that's kind of exciting to us. I think that doesn't really exist on the internet today. We have these real unfiltered experiences and you can kind of like guide people through learning about these topics. And I think it's kind of the early days, but we think about that as being one of the future things the site becomes.
Yeah,
Well, I want to thank you guys, Steve and Vijay, for talking with me for the past hour and talking all things live. And thank you to everybody for attending and everybody watching live on southbysouthwest.com/live. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, guys.